Hey everyone, welcome back. It's time for the latest GoSkills Challenge Solution. How did you do? Well, we're about to find out. Our Excel expert Claudia Buckley has her solution to share. Give it a look and see if yours matches up.
Creating dynamic data validation lists is one thing, but using different sources for dynamic data validation calls for a little extra work. So here's what we did. Our resource hint sent you to Excel's Power Tools. Now, Power Query can transform our source data from three distinct and separate tables into a single list. We have to create connections for each table, then append them into a single table. So here's how. We click anywhere in our first table, then go to Data, and in the Get and Transform Data command group, we click From Selection. Once the Power Query editor loads, and we notice that we have the data from our Java table, then we click the Close and Load arrow, and instead of Close and Load, we click Close and Load 2. Now we only want to create a connection. So we hit Only Create Connection and OK. And notice in the Queries and Connections panel, the Java connection is created. All right, and we need to repeat that for the other two tables. So we go into the Rio table, From Selection, Close and Load 2, and Only Create Connection. The Rio connection is created. Now let's do the Cozy connection. Only Create Connection, and OK. So now we have all three connections here. And now we can right-click on one of these connections, click Append, and we do want to concatenate the data from all three tables. So we select the option that says three or more. We already have Java loaded. Rio will be the next one to add. Cozy is the third one. And we click OK. And what Power Query did was to create a query and call it Append 1, which has all the data from the three tables. Notice our data has 9 rows. So let's rename this table. I'll call it All Products. And now we can click Close and Load. And we have a brand new sheet created here called All Products, and this is a table of the same name. Great. So let's place this here. And now we have the information that we could potentially use as our data validation source list. But we can't reference a table column in a data validation source. So our workaround is to just create a replica of this list of codes by using a dynamic array function. Now you'll see how this solves another problem later, but in terms of dynamic array functions, we can use either unique or sort. I prefer to use sort because that sorts the values in an alphabetical, or in this case, numeric order. So let me use the sort function, and here's the array. So it's going to be using the all products table and the code column. And it sorts them from lowest to highest by default. So now we have this spilled result that's really cool, because it'll update when the source data is applied. So let's go here. Now we create our data validation rules by going to Data, click the data validation icon, and we want to allow a list. The source of that list will be here, and we use the spill range operator, that's the number sign, to refer to all the results in this output. So once we click OK, we have our dropdown list. Now let's check to make sure that it is dynamic. So let's enter a new product code, 1111TT, and let's make that $300. So now we have a new value in our Java table. We do have to click refresh so that our Power Query results get loaded. And here we can see that we now have 10 rows. And here it is. our new product code sorted in ascending order. Nice. Now this works great because I am using Excel 365, which automatically has dynamic arrays. But if your version of Excel doesn't have dynamic arrays, you might want to use the offset function. So let's do that here. We go to data validation, let's delete this reference and use offset to get our data source. So the first thing we need to do is to establish our reference cell. Let's make that the first value here. And we don't want to change the reference point. So 0 rows away, 0 columns away. And what will be the height of our data set? Well, it'll be whatever the length of this list is. And how we go about doing that is doing a count of all the values in this column. We have to be specific in mentioning the sheet name, because remember that the data validation is really taking place in sheet 1. And if we don't put the sheet name here, Excel will assume that we're talking about sheet 1. So let's make sure that we enter the name of our sheet, all products, with that exclamation point, and we're referring to the first column, A to A. So we're doing a count of all the non-blank cells in column A. But we have to remove this one, A1, so -1. So what we're saying here is that the data validation list will be 10 rows in length and only one column wide. Close parenthesis here, hit OK, and let's see if we have the same values. We have the very same values as we did with our spill range operator. Notice that these are not sorted. In fact, they show up in the order that they appear in our list. All right, so this is great. Let's choose one of these. And if you got this far, then getting the price would have been fairly straightforward. And you can use VLOOKUP, but I used XLOOKUP since I have Excel 365. Here's the value we're looking for. Let's use the All Products worksheet and the table here since all the prices are listed. Our lookup array will be here. That's where we expect to find our lookup value. And the value we want returned will come from this column. We can close parenthesis here. And we know that the price for this product is $18.25. Perfect. Now, getting the name of the supplier meant that we had to think, what's the best way to look for a value so that if it's not found, we look somewhere else? Because the supplier name isn't shown here. It's only shown on the first page. Now, your first inclination might have been to think of XLOOKUP because it does have an if not found argument. But both XLOOKUP and VLOOKUP must have the return array running parallel to the lookup array. So VLOOKUP is a vertical search, which means that the return value must also be listed vertically. And XLOOKUP can either go vertical or horizontal, but the return array and the lookup array must run parallel to each other. So those won't work. Speaking of VLOOKUP, we can remember that this function was meant to be an upgrade to index match. But where VLOOKUP fails, we sometimes do have to go back to the old faithful index and match functions. So you might have thought, let's look for a match. And if one is found, it'll return the position number. If one isn't found, it'll return an error. We can use that error to look for another match in the subsequent table. So let's jump right in. Let's start by looking for a match to this value. And where do we want to search? In our first table. That'll be here. Now we have to enter 0 here so that Excel looks for an exact match. Or we can just use the shiny new XMatch. XMatch does an exact match by default, so we can end our formula here. And we do get a value. We get the number 2. Which means that this product code is the second item in the list. So what we really want Excel to do, if we do get a number, then we want to return the name of the supplier shown here. So how do we do that? We want to ask, is it a number? And the answer is yes, true, it is a number. So let's get in front of this formula and say, if it is a number, this is our logical test. The next argument says, what's the value if it is true? If it is true, we want to return this supplier name. And if it's not a number, we want to look in the next table. So we repeat the syntax by referencing a new table. If this logical test, the test for a number, returned by a match of B10 in this column, if it is true, then we return this value. That's the name of the supplier in the second table. And since we have a third table, we do this again. Now, it's unlikely that we'll get a value of false since our product code has specific values. That'll always come from one of these three tables. But let's enter a value of false. So if the product code is not found, what do we want to see returned in our supplier row? Let's enter no supplier found within double quotes. And we can close parentheses here and here and here. All right, so we did expect this to work because this product code was found in the first table. Now let's select one that isn't found in the first table. Let's choose this one. And now we see Cozy Coffee. Here's where that supplier not found might come in handy. Let's say we delete this product by removing the row entirely. So now we only have two products coming from Cozy Coffee. Then supplier not found shows up here. And in that case, it'll also make sense to have an if not found argument for the price. And let's refresh. So price not found. And that's how we solve this challenge. It does happen fairly often that our data is coming from different sources, so it's good to know that Power Query can take care of this for us. Tell us what you think about our solution to this challenge by commenting below or joining the conversation on our Slack channel. See you next time.
So there it is. Did you get the same results? Did you use the same approach? Or did you try something different? We'd like to know. Share your take on the challenge in the comments below or join us for more discussion in our Slack channel. Link in the description. Thanks for participating and make sure to subscribe to this channel to get an alert when the next challenge is released. We'll see you then.